start, first of all, by saying I am not George Clooney, although the resemblance is striking, as Nick, look, Nick mentioned, I'm Alan Peterson, I'm the Road Bridge Division Manager for Arapahoe County. I consider myself the change agent or secret agent change man, a jerk. I oversee the work of 60 really diverse, incredible people. So with that, let me tell you where Arapahoe County is. It's in the northeastern part of the state. It's the first and the oldest county in Colorado, established in, I believe it was 1865. It's a very long, narrow county, 72 miles from one end to the other, and only 12 miles wide. Very urban area next to the Denver Tech Center. Out east, we have another facility in Bennett. I'm told Indians still roam the plains out in the southern part of our county. And I'm here to talk to you today about how my team and I changed the culture in our Road and Bridge Division. And at the same time, I want you to think a little bit about your culture and what your culture looks like. So I'm in the maintenance business. It's we mow roads, we pave streets, we fill potholes. It's not glamorous work, but it's incredibly important work. Our annual budget is about $16 million. We're hoping to see that increase over the next couple of years. So that's just a little background of where Arapahoe County is. As Nick mentioned, I spent almost 25 years in the city of Colorado Springs before abandoning and moving to Arapahoe County. So I'm familiar with the culture in Colorado Springs and how that evolved and how it changed over the years. And have a chance to talk to Jay a little bit about what it looks like today. But when I got to Arapahoe County, I needed to know the 60 people that were reporting to me and get to know them a little better. What I saw was a lot of inefficiencies that bugged me. Poor attitudes are rampant anywhere in any organization, whether it's in public or private sector. People are showing up for late for work and not being held accountable. Disrespecting others and their supervisors and their managers and me. Seldom would people put in a full day. Might work a few hours here, a few hours there, but you know, what's accountable for their entire shift that they were working. I wasn't proud of the workmanship that was going on, and ultimately, I track the cost of everything that we do, from filling a pothole, placing a street sign, to plowing a lane mile of roadway. That was important to me to remain competitive in our business. So once I got a handle on kind of our culture, I'm going to use the cliche, the good old boy system. Is anybody familiar with that? Give you just an idea. I Googled the good old boy system, and I found this picture of these guys. I swear, I don't know them. I hope you don't know them either. And I use this as an example because it just spoke to me. These are good old boys, you can tell. I bet two of them married sisters, you know, to see the other two, their kids play softball together. Does that kind of sound familiar? Oh, wait, some nepotism going on? That's the kind of thing I was seeing. And I saw that seniority meant less responsibility. The longer you were there, the more likely you were to become a good old boy. So these are the guys that are top of their pay range with the least amount of responsibility and the least amount of accountability. I think they felt entitled. They had paid their dues, and thus the new guys were assigned the more technical tasks. So, like I said, a lot of things bugged me right away in my career. I noticed things like this, both in Colorado Springs and in Arapahoe County. But in Arapahoe County, I came in and I said, this does not work. From this day forward, henceforth, and forevermore, we're going to change our start times and we're going to start work at 7 o'clock in the morning instead of 6 o'clock in the morning. Well, the reason they started at 6 o'clock in the morning is so they could get off sooner, avoid traffic going home. We have an ordinance, a county ordinance, that says you can't work in a neighborhood until 7 a.m. and you can't work on a major arterial street until after 9 a.m. And we got guys coming in at 6 o'clock in the morning, on the clock, drinking coffee and putting on their boots and swapping stories. It wasn't efficient, and that bothered me. I didn't like the way they did their snow shifts. actually had four different snow shifts that had like staggering start times. So whether if there was a tradition of snow, then we'd call a snow shift. If you were assigned one of those four shifts, and they carried pagers around. Whoever heard a pager? What? You don't even know what it is. They waited for their pager to go off. They were literally on the clock, sitting at home, watching Judge Judy, waiting for it to snow. That bothered me. Our equipment and personnel mobilization, as I said, our county is 72 miles from one end to the other. So the crew would get the materials and all the equipment they needed, and drive out to the job site, drop everything off, and then make another trip back to the facility to get the rest of the equipment that they needed. And sometimes this would take hours out of the day before the work even began. It drove me nuts. Fortunately, I had a really, and still have, a really talented operations manager, Ray McCampbell, and he designed a trailer, had it built, and we actually have two of them now, that would transport all of the equipment that they needed at one time, make us much more efficient. The other thing that really bugged me, I got a whole list, it's just a few of them. They actually had a hotline where an employee could call in, leave a message, and say, I'm not going to be there today, I'm sick, and hang up. Have you heard that? So if the guys found out that the next day they had a job that was less desirable, they were going to be out in the hot sun or whatever it was, if they didn't like it, they would just call the hotline, sometimes 6 o'clock in the evening or 10 o'clock in the evening, and say, yeah, I'm sick, I'm not going to be there tomorrow. Really put a hamper on getting work done. So I said, no more sick line. You must call your supervisor if you're sick and let him know. Also, vacation time and sick leave were interchangeable. If they ran out of sick leave, the supervisors and managers would let them use their vacation time. Put an end to that. Sick leave is sick leave. If you're sick, your family is sick, use it. But they're not interchangeable. So when it got to the point where the guys were calling in, saying, yeah, I'm sick today, but I don't have any vacation time. Vacation time wasn't pre-approved anyway. It's time off without pay. Our sick leave usage went down, I don't know, some 78% or something like that. It's incredible. But I didn't make a lot of friends making these changes, as you might imagine. I was up against the good old boys, and I met incredible resistance. I nearly had a mutiny on my hands. This was actually the first time I got to meet our HR director and see his office. They were calling in, and I was getting everything but death threats. Not going to live, they don't want to. Can we, so that was my major flaw, is I never explained why these things were important, why it made business sense to change our start times, and why it was important to be efficient, get out to the job quickly with everything you needed, get the work done quickly. So, what do we want a culture to look like? So I kind of had an idea what it was, and this exists in your cultures too, I'm sure. Of course, we want it to be rainbows and unicorns and perfect harmony throughout. So we have, I mentioned that we had two separate facilities, one clear out in Bennett, Colorado, and the other one is in Inglewood, just east of Centennial Airport. Those two groups were very siloed. They never shared information or resources. It just wasn't effective at all, and they struggled with how to bring those two groups together so we could be more efficient and communicate together. We wanted to create a culture where employees were valuable, felt valuable, and weren't treated like lazy, shovely government workers that we tend to be labeled with. Also, I wanted them to understand the importance of the work that we were doing. There's nothing worse than a manager assigning a task just to keep you busy that has no meaning. I hate that, and employees do too. When I take pride in their work, I feel successful. If I had a dollar for every time I heard it's good enough for government work, I wouldn't have to work anymore. So I put a new spin on that, and I'm actually proud to be a government worker. I believe we set the bar of what a new standard should be. So when somebody says, that's good enough for government work, I take that as a compliment and feel that we are on top of our game and provide great service. I also wanted employees to feel like stakeholders, make them feel like the boss. They are. I can't be successful if they're not successful. I really worked hard to make them feel like they're actually stakeholders, stockholders in their own business. And in fact, I often say, consider this your own business. You're the president of the company. You're running a for-profit business. Are you okay signing that guy's paycheck that's sleeping under a shade tree, you know, and when everybody else is working? And you've got employees that hold each other accountable. It's been very successful. So I had the opportunity to meet this guy on a flight to Dallas. This is what he said. His name's Darren Martin. And got to talking to him. He's a change manager who travels the world. He's a speaker. He's got a number of books. In fact, I have one copy of his book. Who wants it? It's an incredible book. It's an incredible book, and he's an incredible speaker. He works with Fortune 500 companies. He's worked with Microsoft. He's done a lot of work with Southwest Airlines. I read his book that he gave me at the airport, and I loved it. I ended up with about 30 more copies and required all of our supervisors and managers to read it, so we were all on the same page. I gave a copy to my director, who had sat in the corner collecting dust for about 3 weeks until I got a phone call from him one afternoon. He said, that book, that is awesome. You got to give me 5 more of those because I'm going to take them to our county commissioners. He had his performance review coming up and he wanted to show what our whole public works department was about. So I bought dozens and dozens and dozens of these books. And I highly recommend reading Darren Martin. He's got several other books as well. So how do you create change without causing chaos and ending up in your HR director's office? Well, this is one of the things that the HR director brought to Arapahoe County. It's the ADCAR model. So ProSide is the tag name, ProSide ADCAR model. So all the managers went through a 3-day change management course. Supervisors went through a day-long change management course. And employees, our staff members, actually attended about, I think it was a 3 or 4 hour training course. What Jeff Hyatt, the inventor of this, says there are 5 key elements in order to create successful, sustainable change. I know how much Nick loves acronyms, so ADCAR is the acronym for awareness. You have to bring awareness and the need to change before you can be successful. You have to have the desire to participate and support the change. I think that's probably the most difficult of all, because you can't make somebody desire change. You can't make somebody come to work with a positive attitude. But what you can do is build that awareness and make them aware of the consequences if you don't change. And sometimes they're pretty drastic, up to and including termination. I love Lou Holtz's famous quote. He was the head coach for Notre Dame for many, many years. He said, it's easy to motivate people. You just get rid of all of those that aren't motivated. And there are HR people in the room. they cringe when I say that. So you got to build that desire. Knowledge, you have to know how to change. What are we going to look like? How are we going to implement this change? Ability, you have to have the ability to implement new skills and behavior. A lot of our guys didn't have that ability. They'd never been taught how to properly operate a paving machine. So we wrote into our contracts when we purchased equipment that there are vendors that come and spend a week in the field with us, training and teaching us the ins and outs. We brought in subject matter experts. We went through, it's a Franklin Covey course, Leadership at the Speed of Trust. That taught us to trust. It was a 3-day class. Incredible. And we implemented what we were learning. And then finally, with any change management, any change, of course, you've got to reinforce it, celebrate your victories. And our Arapahoe Road Bridge knows how to do that. So, you know, the old adage, have you eaten an elephant? You know, one way at a time. I would never eat an elephant. I think the meat's probably really tough. So, stick. I highly recommend following this ADCAR model. We broke it down into 2 pieces, building trust and communication. And that's how we sought out to change our culture. We gained trust from those that had none. We extended trust where it needed to be, so a little more on that later. And then we had to restore trust when it was broken. And there are specific steps you can take. We also started communicating honestly. showing some empathy, that we really cared for our employees and our staff and our families. And you have to be sincere about it. They read you. If you're not sincere about changing the culture, they know it. And all you're doing is adding to the problem and creating another silo of good old boys. The other thing was building trust. So this was really eye-opening for me. I didn't trust our employees. I knew a couple of them, but I didn't trust them. I had good reasons not to trust them also. So I had to look myself in the mirror and say, I'm going to get to know these guys. I scheduled one-on-one interviews, or just a chance to get to know each other. 1 hour for all 60 employees. It took me over 4 months between meetings and other duties and responsibilities, but I finally got through every employee. I wanted to know what drives them, what inspires them. What is their life story? How did they end up in a road and bridge maintenance division? And I showed empathy and I cared. I had some really great conversations. I left myself a little vulnerable, but at the same time, I built some incredible trust among our staff in doing so. I was also able to identify who was on my side and who were going to be my challenges. That's important to know. It also gave me a chance to clarify what my vision was for our road and bridge division, not just next month or, you know, next quarter, but what does it look like in a year, 3 years, in 5 years? And now we're having conversations about what are we going to look like in 10 years? I tell people, if we look the same in 5 years that we do today, something is broken, something went really wrong. We have dug a hole that we can't get out of. So being able to share my vision and also my expectations was critical. I tell you, I'm the easiest guy you ever want to work for. I only have 3 requirements, and the first 2 are like free. You got to show up to work on time. You have to work on time. I'm from that culture. My dad always said, if you weren't 15 minutes early, you were late. I don't expect everybody to be 15 minutes early, but I don't like to see a guy coming in at 7:03 that's not ready to go to work. So I set that expectation and made it very clear. Second one is do your job. Do what you're paid to do. Do it all day long. Not just a couple hours in the morning, a couple hours in the day. Do your job, what you're expected to do, your whole shift. The third one takes some time and some energy and it's not so easy. And that's to strive for excellence every day. I struggle with that at times myself, but if we keep telling each other every day, tomorrow I'm going to be better than I was today, it grows and breeds and enthusiasm ensues. So communication, this was another big tip, like building trust and communicating. When I first started, I went to the operations manager and I said, so what do you got planned for your guys today? What are you going to do tomorrow and next week? He said, Alan, or George, we have all of that. We have all that, but we don't share that with staff. Because if we do, they see what's on the schedule, and if they don't like the job that they're doing, they call in the sick hotline. And instead of others picking up the slack, they'll just postpone the job until they were fully staffed to be able to do something. I was knocking my head. I said, well, I didn't believe this. They said, no, we're going to post our schedules. We're going to let everybody know what is expected of them every day, every month, every quarter, throughout the whole year. We're going to hold them accountable to do that job. And if they don't, that's a performance issue. That's not a sick leave. So we address a lot of that. We talk about success a lot. What does success look like and how do you get there? Give a lot of examples. I mentioned setting clear, crystal clear expectations. So they're not only written down in performance evaluation at the end of the year, but we talk about them all year long, what those expectations are. And we hold everybody accountable. We share important information at all levels of the organization. So every other Monday, I have a division manager's meeting with my peers and my director where they share events that affect the county. I take that information, and the following day, I have a meeting with our supervisors and managers, and I convey the information that I learned the previous day. Conversely, the supervisors take that information and share it with their crews, a day, sometimes 2 days later, but everybody's getting the same information at the same time. At the same time, employees that have questions or concerns or issues are absolutely allowed to raise their conditions through, you know, the chain of command. I take them to my director, we hash them out, and finally close the loop. can't just leave an employee hanging out there. You got to close that loop. So that was really important. So much to hear concerns and, okay, we'll take care of it. And the employee never hears again, and they feel discounted. So I also encourage everyone to do a policy, but we insist on a chain of command. And the reason I do that is because if that employee didn't like his assignment or had some controversy with a coworker, they would never go to their supervisor or their manager. They were calling up the HR director. Next thing you know, I'm in the director's office explaining why we're doing this. You know, I finally got some trust and some buy-in, but it took a while. I think some effort. So I consider going over your supervisor's head or your manager's head, I consider that insubordination, and it's reflected on a performance evaluation. Then we created an employee committee. I've served on a lot of employee committees. I've chaired them, I've sat on them. It seems in my experience, just my own opinion, the success of employee committees are short-lived. It came out with some really good information, did some great things. They came up with an award where employees could recognize each other. They created a thing that's called the Life Happens Fund. You could voluntarily put in $10, and if an employee had a life-changing event, a death in the family, a new child, whatever, the employee committee would give them a gift card to Babies R Us or Cabela's or something like that. So they did some good things. However, I believe it was short-lived. And I'll tell you why. It soon became what I consider, it was a party coordinating club. They would sit around and talk about who's going to cater the meal for our next employee quarterly meeting. That wasn't the intention of the employee committee. We were looking for innovative ideas was the whole idea behind it. I also saw it becoming very exclusive instead of inclusive, so they would plan bowling nights and happy hour after work. And what it reminded me of is not getting the invitation to the popular girls' birthday party in seventh grade. And what that felt like, that's what we were doing. We were excluding really smart employees. I just didn't like the way it felt. The employee committee voted, you get this, they voted on changing our start time back to 6 a.m. Yeah, we had to bring them back in. It's not democracy, you're not a voting body. It's policy, you explain the business reason. You know, so I had just some good people, but not a lot of direction. So what happened is the supervisor stepped in and started giving the employees some direction. Hey, why don't you work on this? Why don't you work on this? Pretty soon it wasn't an employee committee at all. It was supervisors bringing their issues and ideas forward. So it wasn't a true employee committee, and there was such a lack of communication. If you were on the committee, you got firsthand information of what was going on in the county. If you weren't on the committee, the information you got, if you got it, was filtered and this wasn't effective. And I could just see that kind of good old boy concept evolving again. And I don't want to make that sound so negative because we all create our own good old boy systems. We tend to hire and promote those that think like you and act like you. And I say mix it up. I have an incredibly boring job if my other two managers thought exactly like I do. We lock horns on a regular basis, nearly daily. But we have one common goal, and that is we all want to do the right thing. And that's what links us. And that's what helps us hire and retain really dynamic, diverse employees. So we put in a paradigm shift on the employee committee. We are now an employee committee with 60 full-time employees, and everyone has an equal voice. We were toying with the idea, it's in the infant stages, but we're putting a board up in both of our facilities. We've already named it, it's called the Thought Spot, where you just write your ideas, it can be anonymous or you can put your name on it, but when you have ideas, you put them on the board, and then I'm committed to every one of our staff meetings that we have every other Tuesday. I will take those things, bring them to the supervisors, they will be addressed, we will close the loop and follow through, even if it's, you know, that was a really bad idea, or no, how many times do I have to tell you we're not going to start at 6 a.m.? So that's in the event stage. The really exciting thing that we did was we branded our division. It was really important to me to bring the West and that East group together to function as one. As corny as it sounds and as silly as it is, we created created the Lee brand, separate from West and East. We had it embroidered on all of our apparel, our uniforms, even made, we had pop sockets made so you could text and drive at the same time. No, don't text and drive at the same time. We even have our own mascot, we have a Wee Man. This is one of our supervisors that was playing around at one of our staff meetings. We have some fun with this. Our HR department got a hold of this and has invited Wee Man and some managers to come around to his other classes where they're teaching the ProSite at our model, and we tell our success story in front of other classes and how we implemented change. You're gonna love this too. This is a picture of our Public Works picnic with 130 employees, and we have tattoos made. The families are with them too. Please pass those around if you would. I don't know if there's enough to probably have to open that package. But if you just get your skin wet and hold that tattoo up there with a damp rag for about 30 seconds or so, peel it off really close, you will know what it feels like to be part of Team Wee. I might also mention that you won't be able to get this off for about 2 weeks. So don't put them on your neck or anything. But something so silly has caught on and it's been contagious. We found some scrap material in our science and marketing shop and made some banners. And we hung these banners in our locker rooms and in the restrooms and in both facilities. It's just a reminder for employees to don't forget to be awesome on your way out the door. On the right there, I probably can't see it, but that's another huge banner that hangs in both of our facilities. At the end of the year, at our fourth quarter year-end meeting, we take these banners down and bring them in, and we have all the new employees come up and sign them. I look at it as a binding contract that they will remember to strive for excellence. They will be part of the team. They will try to get better every day, et cetera, et cetera. So everybody has a org chart. It's a hierarchy, who's at the top, who's at the bottom. I think this is an HR tool. It does not make us no good at all. So when they told me that I needed to turn in my new updated org chart with our new employees, we had quite a few of them. This is what I said. I think this is really symbolic of what we stand for. This is what we're, and the only reason we did this is because I couldn't get everybody's name on one line. You know, so this is what we stand for. Increased productivity. Here's just one example, and I know my time's running out. Our patching crew in 2015 put 200 tons of asphalt down from filling potholes. In 2016, that same six-man crew put 2,700 tons of asphalt down. That's potholes and asphalt repairs. I think the supervisor that manages that is back there, Keith Runyon, so I give him a lot of credit for making that happen. People are more flexible and willing to change. We talk about change all the time. And, you know, what it looks like today probably is not going to be what it looks like tomorrow. Everybody is committed to continual improvement and a positive, sustainable culture. Best thing of all, it keeps me on the HR director's office and in the county attorney's office. So why should you change? It's a lot like herding cats. It's hard work. Let me take just a minute to give you, I've drawn this out hundreds of times from people, but I think it's important. You're born 18 to 25 years old, you join the workforce, you get married, you go to college, you go to the army, whatever you do. Most people try to retire between 62 and 65, unless that Powerball thing happens to work out. And the life expectancy today in the United States is between 84 and 86 years old. My point is, you have this whole chunk of your life, nearly 50 years of your life, and if you're unhappy in your job or in your life, please do something about it. Change it starting today. So if this looks familiar, perhaps, they resonate with you, or this is the guy in the cubicle next to you. Heather, I'd love your last slide to take a picture of it because it reminded me of this. So if this looks familiar, I challenge you to change your culture. Thank you.